Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I see a lot of beautiful faces for the first time in a long time. Not because you all weren't beautiful before, because we were all covered in masks. And as you know, and I sent out a letter, all those who've been vaccinated according to the CDC guidelines, there are no longer requirements for masking or social distancing. Those who have not been vaccinated, again, according to CDC guidelines, we'd like you to continue to wear a mask, but this is an honor system type deal. So we ain't checking. You all do what you want, but that's the policy, okay? So we're going by the CDC guidelines. If you come to the church during the week, so on the weekends, if you're masked, if you're vaccinated, no mask, that's fine. But if you come to the church during the week from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. while daycare is here, we are asking everyone, vaccinated or non-vaccinated, everyone to wear a mask, because the daycare is still required to have wear a mask. And we want to send a signal for parents coming in that within our church community, within the church during those hours, everyone's wearing a mask until you come into the office or until you come into a room if you have a meeting and shut the door. And then you can take your mask off. Is that understandable? Okay, so again, the same scheduling about if you want to use rooms or parts of the church, check. You need to call the office, check with me, and we'll make sure that happens. But right now, we're following the CDC guidelines, and we're good to go. So it's great to see everyone, especially on Pentecost, as we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit and the unity and the oneness of Christians around the world as we celebrate communion and as we gather together as a community of faith. So welcome, everyone. Do we have any announcements that we need to make? Okay, no announcements for today. Any joys and concerns we want to share? Yes, Doreen. Say it again. Now, I get it moved because I can't hear you. As my children say, I can't hear a thing, so I'm going to have to move closer to you. Thank you, Rich. Dottie. Dottie passed. Okay, Dottie passed. Okay. Waiting for a transplant. Who else? Bob. Kensington. Turning four. Okay. Yes.
My brother-in-law, Steve, who we met here, has a collapsed lung.
So oh, wow. For everyone's just again, we're still continuing Zoom and YouTube and the audio files. Meetings are going to be a mix, or we're going to be developing a plan that if you still would like to meet by Zoom, that option will be available. And those people who want to meet in person, again, that option will be available. So there will be a mix, a hybrid. So we'll still work out the details on that, but that's going to happen. But same thing with worship. Right now, we still have Zoom and we still have YouTube. So I want to make sure everyone knows. Dottie passed away. She was waiting for a transplant. It didn't happen, and she passed away. Doreen Legge, have you sent information? Kensington, Bob Hawk's youngest granddaughter, is turning four, and Steve has a collapsed lung, Jim Sage's brother-in-law. So any others? Yes.
I want to praise for the ladies of the church getting together this Wednesday. It was a beautiful time, and hopefully we have more get-togethers now.
This coming or this past
week?
Past.
Yep.
Ladies of the church met this past Wednesday. Okay, great.
Yeah, I'm hoping for more.
And looking for more. Anyone else? Again, once again, it's great to see everyone, and let's now center ourselves on the worship of God.
It is a great morning. Pentecost, it's a beautiful sunny day, and for those of us that don't need to wear masks, it's even better. So anyway, let us join together in our responsive call to worship. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works, who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing my praise to my God while I have being. May my meditations be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let sinners be consumed from the earth, and let the wicked be no more. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. Let us worship God.
So if this song doesn't get you snapping your fingers and little, you know, blood moving in your body this morning, then you need to check your pulse this morning. Check your pulse. Go ahead, Scott.
Feel the spirit. Time.
A little louder, Scott.
Feel the spirit moving in my heart. I will pray upon the mountains. My Lord spoke, out of his mouth came fire and smoke, and all around me feels so fine. I ask my Lord if all this was mine. Oh, every time I heart, I will pray. Georgia River.
Lisa. Let us go to God in unison and ask for his mercy and grace. O breath of God, we rejoice that you have sent the power of your Holy Spirit into our lives, and we celebrate today as Pentecost and in remembrance of your Spirit descending onto the church. Forgive us when we seek to forsake your Holy Spirit for our sin. Enable us to resist and remain steadfast in righteousness.
In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Christian friends, the reality of Pentecost is it unites us in the Spirit, but also tells us that as a united Christians, we still sin and fall short of God's glory. But that Spirit within us draws us back to Christ, draws us back to God, draws us back to righteousness. So hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Let's remain standing and affirm what we believe by sharing together the Apostles' Creed.
The Nicene Creed.
I like this one because no one knows it, and so I don't feel so bad reading it. Okay, the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again from the dead and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us pray that God will open our hearts and minds. O Lord of Spirit and fire, we come to you so that our hearts will be inflamed by the Holy Spirit. Empower us to be bold and clear on how we listen and hear your word, and then share it with our family, friends, and all who come into our lives. We ask you this all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first reading comes from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, verses 18 27. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope, that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For this, in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. May the Lord bless this reading and our understanding of his most holy word.
So this morning, the song that I have for you is called Build Your Kingdom Here. So if you're scratching your head this morning, wondering what Pentecost is, some of you may think, I've heard that word, but I don't know exactly what that means. That's the when the church began, the beginning of the Christian church. So I found this quote by the writers of this song. It's Wren Collective. Anybody ever heard of that group, Wren Collective? Yeah, so this is from one of their, the lead singer. He said, the idea of Build Your Kingdom Here is that wherever you are, at school, at work, at home, that here is exactly where you are right now. God's kingdom is his church. Not God, please build your kingdom in Africa. It's right here, right now. And as the body of Christ, our hope is that as churches around the world sing the song, it'll be stirring their faith and they'll live out the truth of the song. So I want you to really listen to the lyrics of this one.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. Seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives. For you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released. The hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church, we pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on.
darkness clear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land, set your church on fire, win this nation back, change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray.
I just want to, one thing Mike asked me to mention, and I did not, but I will now. Next Sunday is Compassion Sunday. So we're going to be talking about, we've done Compassion International Sunday before, about sponsoring children throughout the world. And that next Sunday, we're going to be doing that again. So we'll look forward to that. So I just want to make sure everyone knew about that. When we think of Pentecost, we always go back to Acts chapter 2. Because Pentecost... Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21, begins that conversation of the first Pentecost, as well as the first message immediately once the Spirit descended upon all believers. So that's what we're going to talk about today. So we're in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. One tech thing, does it matter where I stand now? Okay.
So Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21.
When the day of Pentecost arrived, we were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in their other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Pagera and Pamphylia, Egypt and other part and the parts of Libya belonging to the Cyrene and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others mockingly said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. 'Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. In the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. And sun shall turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Today is Pentecost. And it's interesting, I found out that Pentecost is the Greek for the Hebrew Shavuot, meaning Pentecost, the Feast of the Weeks. Now, one of the things we see here in Pentecost is a gathering. It happened in Jerusalem, and it happened in the upper room, and it happens today in churches around the world. Because Pentecost is the story, the beginning of our story. It's the coming of the Holy Spirit upon all Christians, which calls us to be united and undivided in our faith, hope, and love, towards each other and to others outside the church as we share this objective truth, the objective truth that Jesus Christ is Lord. So this is an important, important day. And it reminds me of something that was told to me not too long ago about telling the story. Sometimes on special days, we just want to hear the story. And Pentecost is one of those days. It's a integral part of the church calendar. It is the day when we celebrate. Some of us wear red. Other people forget to wear red. That's me. And but it's the point that we all are to be united in understanding what this day means. So it's part of the old, old story. But this is how our story begins. Because the incarnation and the resurrection mean nothing unless Pentecost happens. Because unless Pentecost happens, none of us get it. We weren't there at the incarnation. We weren't there at the resurrection. But Pentecost is with us always. And it is being called to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We are filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. But it's a struggle to understand this as an individual thing as well as a community thing. We often in our society believe that becoming a Christian is very individualistic. I am a Christian because Christ, I proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord. God entered me, therefore I am a Christian. And though that's not untrue, the greater truth is that we are part of the greater body, the whole body, the church. People have said, I can be a Christian by myself. My question to them would be, where do you get that? It ain't from Scripture. Certainly it's not from Scripture. Nothing that we understand that God tells us is from that. So that's just coming from your own desire to be by yourself. But to be a Christian means to be in community, to be part of a fellowship of faith, to be part of the church. Now, what is the church? Now, again, in the Reformed tradition, and oftentimes in the Protestant tradition, the church is classified between the visible church and the invisible church. The visible church is anyone and everyone who's ever belonged to a church, anyone who's come into the church, those who have died, those who are actually alive, I think. But the invisible church is everyone who believes Jesus Christ is Lord, who says Jesus is Lord. They constitute the invisible church, past, present, and future. And it's the invisible church that's filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, where Pentecost truly has its meaning and truth. So let's go to what Scripture says, and let's look at it from that perspective. So when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. The 150 people in the upper room that had been told, go and wait by Christ until the Spirit comes, until the companion comes. So they're gathering together, about 150 of them. And suddenly there was a sound from heaven of a rushing mighty wind, and it was filled the house where all they were sitting, and there appeared upon them tongues like as fire, and it set upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now that's kind of different, but this begins the story. This begins the church. This begins when people now take what happened and go out and share boldly, courageously, sacrificially who Jesus Christ is. And this is the first time. But this is the first and one time, because at this point, Christians, in my belief, past, present, and future, all had the implanting of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit comes upon all those who've been called to salvation, past, present, and future. So those of us here today and those, our family, our friends, our neighbors, our the people we work with, whoever they may be, even if they have yet to come to faith, the Spirit of God resides within them, guiding them towards that moment in time when God will inflame it and they will understand So in many ways, this is the first and one time that the Spirit comes upon all people who are called and to salvation. Now, putting in context of what happened later, they were staying in Jerusalem, these God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, a crowd gathered together in bewilderment because each of them heard their own language being spoken. Now, they were confused. Why were they confused? Because suddenly people who may not have heard their language for months or years hear someone speaking the language they know. It's like if you've ever been in a foreign country and you go into a place where you expect no one to speak English and suddenly someone does. You go, whoa. And sometimes you were drawn to that person to say, hey, you speak English. And we go on that. Or if any other language, I've seen it before, and I can imagine many of us have as well, that moment in time when, oh, this is not what I expected, but it's great to hear. So they would gather together and say, okay, this is interesting. What's going on? Sometimes we get confused. And this is, in some ways, almost a reversal of the Tower of Babel. Remember that story? Suddenly they had one language, then everyone started speaking different languages, and they created this disunity. But here, people are speaking different languages, and it's creating a unity. People are gathering. And the part of the amazing thing is, have you ever heard the term polyglot? Polyglot? It's someone who can speak a bunch of different languages. I knew this one guy, he could speak 8 different languages. When I went to Kenya as a Peace Corps volunteer, we were supposed to learn Kiswahili. He learned it before we even got there. He was so special. And then he learned 2 other languages in the 8 weeks of training we were at. And then while he was in his site, he learned like 3 more languages. It was amazing. He was a polyglot. He could learn languages so easily. I was still struggling with Habari, meaning hello. But here they're seeing all these different people speaking all these different languages. And they were amazed and astonished. And why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we each hear from them in our own language to which we were born? Again, that concept of being amazed, just being so like blown away, because these were Galileans. Now, we can fill in the blank with what we think of looking at a group of people and going, yeah, really? They know something. The Galileans were not considered very bright. They were not considered educated. They were fishermen. They were farmers. Nothing against fishermen and farmers, but back in the day, no one would expect they to know anything more than Aramaic. They weren't even expected to know Hebrew, because Hebrew was still an educated language. They were certainly not expected to know Greek. But here, these folks were learning, speaking languages that, again, the amazement is, how in the world would they ever know these languages? They're Galileans. But they were. So you had these Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. Now, if you looked on a map, and you can see the center of the map is Jerusalem. These are people from almost all different aspects, the reaches of the Roman Empire. They had all come to Jerusalem. They had come to Jerusalem for the festival of Pentecost, for the festival of weeks, of the harvesting of the wheat. This is one of the 3 big times when you're supposed to gather in Jerusalem: Passover, Pentecost, and this other one called Sukkot, which is the festival of the tabernacles or the tents. So this was a big holiday. So they came from all different places. And when you traveled back then, you didn't go for a couple of days. You didn't get your frequent flyer miles to jet there, jet back. You traveled months and you stayed sometimes years. And so here they are at somewhat of a crossroads where all these people have gathered, all these Jews have gathered. And that's something to keep in mind. These are Jews. We're not even talking Gentiles yet. We're not talking people who are not, who, if you're not a Jew, this in many ways is not us in the sense that we're there. We weren't seeing Romans come to faith. We weren't seeing Gentiles and Greeks come to faith. This is all Jews from around the empire, the Roman Empire, were gathered here. And as I said, the spirit that entered them is the spirit that entered us as Gentiles. And this crossroads became an important source of Jerusalem because this is where Christianity began to spread. So in amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, what does this mean? And some, however, made fun of them, saying they have had too much wine. That's always a good question when you're in doubt. What does this mean? That's a question seeking information. But do you have a heart of ready to receive information, or is it just some throw? Well, I don't know what this means. They obviously were thinking something else, that these individuals were drunk. But even then, that says, you know, it says a drunk man's words are a sober man's thoughts. Okay. But how would a Galilean know his thoughts in Parthenian? So Peter, knowing what they're thinking, or they might have been very vocal in what they're thinking, stands up. He's one of the 11. Remember, Judas is dead. So he raised his voice and addressed the crowd, fellow Jews and all you who live in Jerusalem. Let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I'm saying. Now, he's getting their attention. He's beginning his message. They don't know what's coming, but they do know this one individual who is speaking is going to share something. And they are curious, if nothing else, to what he's about to say. And he says, let me explain what's going on. Because maybe you don't know, especially since you're visitors. And remember at what time this happened. This wasn't a week away from Jesus' death. This was 50 days away from Jesus' death. Jesus died 53 days before and resurrected 50 days before. And now their Pentecost is happening. So it's been a while. It's been almost 2 months. But he begins, we are united. We are believers. And though we start here as 11, maybe 150 more, we are sharing a united message to you so you can be united with us, regardless of race, color, or creed. And so he starts off trying to get the elephant in the room out of the way. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you're supposed to. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. He says, we're sober. We're sober as a judge. And some of them, I had to show this. And if they had been drinking, they ain't going to drink again because now they have a message to share. And he says, and this is what's spoken. So he begins with what they will understand, the prophets. He goes with the prophet Joel. And this is what was spoken of through the prophet Joel. Do you remember I preached on this passage not too long ago? So if you remember that, bring it into here. The focus is not so much the prophecy and the dreams, but it's about the end message. So, and it shall be in the last days, God said, in the last days, God says, that I will pour forth of my spirit on all mankind, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. So we've already talked about the idea of dreams and visions. That God can come to us in our dreams and visions to communicate what Scripture affirms and what we're called to do as part of His plan for our lives. No vision will ever contradict Scripture, ever contradict God's word, but it can propel us to share God's word with others in the world. And that's exactly what's happened in the last days. There will be this outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Unlike before, where the Holy Spirit came almost in dribs and drags, in the little drops that this individual and that person over there will get it, and they will come filled with the Holy Spirit to share with us, but we won't get it because we don't have the Spirit. But now it's like an open faucet. There's an outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon all God has chosen for salvation. We are not just filled with the Holy Spirit, it's filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. That day is coming. So the question is, are we living in those days? Sometimes we get all scared about the last days, the end of history. And Joel obviously doesn't make it a lot more exciting because he talks about things that can be sound a little strange. The book of Revelation, the last half of Daniel, the 13th chapter of Mark, all talk about something that's coming and none of it seems to sound good. So the question are we living in the last days? And the last days began in truth on Pentecost. That began the process of being in the last days. So Peter continues, even upon my bondservants, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor and smoke. I think people were pretty good until you got to the blood part. Blood kind of freaks us out. And we do like seeing signs and wonders in heaven. I mean, if you are interested in what's in the sky, you can see eclipse and comets and all sorts of different things. Remember, the incarnation comes with a star in heaven. We have times where Moses lifts up his hand and time seems to stop. We see these celestial changes, these signs and wonders that foreshadow the coming of a new day. Something different. But it's not called for us to be afraid. It's a call for us to hope. As Mike read from Romans, hope that is seen is not hope. It's only hope that is unseen. So though we see a sign in heavens that should tell us something's a coming, and we can have hope in that change, in that newness. And it concludes, the sun and shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Okay, the moon turning to blood, that again, ain't fun. The sun darkening. Back in the day when we had an eclipse, total eclipse, people freaked out because that would seem to be the end of the world. And it still is kind of different. But it tells us the day will come when the sun will darken and the moon will turn to blood. And this will be the day of the Lord. And again, the wonder is, what is this? When will it happen? Is it today? Is it tomorrow? Is it tomorrow? But we know two things. One, it's going to be great and awesome, magnificent. And it's going to be kind of a bummer. And the great and awesome part, the magnificent part, is for those who believe, for those who've been filled with the Holy Spirit. For those who haven't, okay, not going to be so much fun. So movies, books, and describe it as this almost apocalyptic thing. We don't have to worry about that. Because as Christians, we are confident in the hope And we share that hope so other people can be confident in it. So what is this day of the Lord? Just again, what is it? It's Pentecost and it's judgment. Pentecost has happened. The Spirit has come upon us. Now we're living through that interim time until God, at his timing and his choosing, will call us to be judged. But until then, we are called to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That is our calling, the bond of peace within our fellowship. Now and here present, our bond of peace with communities around the world that believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the bonds of peace with all those who are seeking faith, hope, and love. Remember in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13, faith, hope, and love remain. And the greatest of these is love. So in the unity of the Spirit, we speak the truth of Jesus Christ in love. We don't back down from the truth. We don't hide from the truth. We don't pretend the truth isn't the truth. We know and exclaim with love and gentleness that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. This is what Pentecost enables us to do. It's the beginning of our story of stepping out and sharing with the world that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. We do that with faith, hope, and love. We do that with gentleness. We do that in a way that people know that the Spirit within them begins to inflame and blossom and speak to them that now they can go and share that good news. The good news that salvation has come into the world. And salvation is found in no one else except Jesus Christ. And as they acknowledge the Spirit within them, they are saved. And that salvation comes only through one thing, the acknowledgement that Jesus Christ is Lord. That is today. That is tomorrow. That is every day of our lives. Our acknowledgement that Jesus Christ is Lord, the unity and the undivided connection we have with Christians, no matter who they are, and the ability to boldly share that in a world that is increasingly hostile to it. And you know, when we gather around this table, we do so in order to proclaim that truth, to be empowered with the Holy Spirit, so that when we go out there, we're not afraid and we're willing to be sacrificial. We're willing to share the truth. Because we love Christ and we know who he is. Jesus Christ is Lord now and always. In his holy name, amen. Christians, we do gather around this table. We're taking communion here by coming forward, coming through the center aisle. And then you can do it individually. You can do it as a group, as one person can come and get the number of people in their group, and then go back to side aisles and have that flow. For those at home, they can use any sort of bread, any sort of juice, because it ties us, binds us with Christians wherever they may be, on YouTube, on Zoom, on Facebook, other congregations. We are united in this act because we are stated in this act to whom we belong and to what we proclaim, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your son. We thank you for the proclamation that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. We know that our story begins at Pentecost and enables us to share that truth with the world. Let us share it with each other, and let us share it with those who have yet to hear, so that the Spirit within them can blossom and inflame. Lord, let your Spirit be in us and among us with rushing sound and tongues of fire internally to in all partake of this blessed meal. We ask this all in your son's holy name. Amen. Christian friends, we're told on the night in which our Lord and Savior was betrayed, after supper, he took a loaf of bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, supper, he took a cup and says, this cup is the covenant of my blood. Drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The table is set. The invitations have gone out. Let us now understand that we gather together as a family. Pentecost unity. Christian friends, this is the body of Christ. Take a knee. This is the blood of Christ for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we gather with joy in understanding that we are tied and bound not just to you, to your Son Jesus Christ, but bound and tied to each other. For all those who proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord are brothers and sisters, members of the same family, united forever, despite the fact that we might seem to be divided by denominations and traditions, but united in the common realization that we know that you are Lord and Savior. We confess with our tongues that you are Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised you from the dead. We are saved. because we cannot make that proclamation without having been filled with the Holy Spirit to overflowing. So we rejoice and give you glory every day. Lord, we thank you for our graduates and look forward to the celebration on June 6th. We ask your blessings on all those around the world who have suffered the illness of COVID or have lost family members. We thank you that we are at a period right now that we can be unmasked. We can have less social distancing. Lord, let things in our country become better and better. Let things around the world become better and better. And let this have learned, we have learned things from this. Lord, we also ask your blessings on those in our congregation who are ill or injured. We ask you to continue to support Pat Nickel as she supports her sister Gay, and as Roger supports them both. Be with Jason, a friend of Belinda's, who is off to Dallas Theological Seminary. Continue to be with the Holloman family and Adam and Cassie Emil. We thank you that Adam is adjusting to his duties in Bahrain despite 107 degree temperatures. Continue to be with Cassie as she supports him and learns to live within the loneliness of being here in Pittsburgh. We ask you to be with Lorenzo, who lost his mother this past week. Give him strength, give him support. And we thank you for all those who gather around him and love him. And we thank you for his wonderful, infectious joy in life. We ask you to continue to be with Dave Nickel as he works on getting his knee in better shape. Be with Donna McKinney, who has moved to the North Hills. And we ask that you let her adjust well to her new environment there. And we rejoice that she remains a part of this church. Be with Darlene, Kathy Lewis's friend who has a brain issue. Be with Jim, who's been working through some health issues as well. Be with Dottie, a friend of Doreen Legs, who's passed away, waiting for a transplant. And Kensington, Bob Hawk's granddaughter, who's turning four today. Be with Jim Sage's brother-in-law, Steve, who also had a collapsed lung from something, tuba playing or something, but heal him. And we rejoice that the ladies of the church were able to meet in person on Wednesday and had a wonderful time and look for greater opportunities to fellowship as a community of faith. Lord, we ask your blessings upon us each and every day. We know we can turn to you. Give us your strength. Give us your presence. Give us the acknowledgement that your Son is with us and in us, living through us through the power of the Holy Spirit. And thank you for all that are gathered here today, those who are on Zoom, those who will watch later on YouTube, tying us and binding us one together in faith. Bless us, keep us as we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Christian friends, right now we're still leaving our offering baskets in the back. For those who come in, they can leave their offerings there. If they can leave their offerings. We encourage people on YouTube and Zoom and audio to send their offerings in, because everything that we do seeks to further the ministry, proclaim the word that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for these gifts. We thank you so much for what you are doing with them. Empower us to empower others to proclaim your word wherever it may send them. And Lord, we thank you for what you do for us and in us and through us as we proclaim your Son. In your Son's holy name, amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him.
Christian friends, we leave this place, let us leave knowing we are unified, undivided as believers and followers of Jesus Christ, filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. And in that overflowing, let us share with the world who we believe in, who we are claimed by. And salvation belongs to all those that have been called, and it is our job to share that with the world. Now, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit, be with each and every one of us now and always. Amen.